Anybody else, high-profile cases?
Well, I think we always, I'm always aware, especially on the average case, the public isn't looking that closely at what we do. But I do think it's very important for us as a profession to be very mindful when the public at large is getting a glimpse into what we do, because it really isn't like television. There's very important issues we address. So, you know, one of the main things is I make sure that I am very clear in a pretrial order, or I have rules I post on my website about what my expectations are of lawyers. Certainly the press, is able to see that. I'm very mindful if I have a room full of reporters that I prepare what I want to say. I know we always do it, but I prepare it in a way. I was a news reporter before I became a judge, too, one of the many things I did. And I know oftentimes they're juggling a lot of things. They don't really understand the depth of what's going on, so I try to make sure that I'm prepared what I'm going to say in very direct and concise language to do it, but I prepare it in a way. I was a news reporter before I became a judge, too, one of the many things I did. And I know oftentimes they're juggling a lot of things. They don't really understand the depth of what's going on, so I try to make sure that I'm prepared what I'm going to say in very direct and concise language that they can process, and that I give some general explanation and put things into context. Recently, I had a news reporter who made a big deal about a plea being taken under seal, and we have a practice that we take pleas under seal because we don't want to reveal to the public and the Bureau of Prisons, people in prison, when people are cooperating. And I realized, because I didn't have a notice on my door or on my website, that all pleas were taken under seal for that purpose. There was a policy decision that we made, that a big deal was made out of nothing, and the public thought something was going on that wasn't. You know, so the only way to correct that was then to post that information. So I'm always mindful of the importance of the public at large really knowing and having an appreciation for what we do, and that we are always, at our best. So I have a good breakfast and a nice cup of coffee, so I'm not grumpy. but again, just keeping in mind that the people who aren't lawyers are having to process that information and what it means to them.
In that regard, I also think that we're talking before about both victims and family members at sentencings. These guidelines are daunting for everybody. And since we have to go through the guideline calculation, if I see that there are family members or people in the courtroom, and this is usually not the white collar case that I'm talking about, I will explain. I'll say, let me just explain how this sentence is going to proceed. And we have these guidelines. I sometimes hold up the book. And, and they're advisory. But we have to first go through these calculations. We'll get to the important stuff about talking about Mr. Jones and his background a little later, but I want to make sure everybody agrees. So explain it to the people in the gallery. They're our audience, too, in the low-profile case, mm-hmm. and they're a very important audience. In the high-profile case, one of the things an early law clerk of mine who had been a speechwriter for Jesse Jackson told me one time, she said, "Judge, have you thought what you want your 30-second soundbite to be?" And I always remember that the reporters who are there for a big case, whether it's a sentencing or a status conference or something, will write a takeaway. They're not going to work their way through, a two-hour hearing necessarily unless they're really focused on that case. They're not going to read a 100-page opinion or a 50-page opinion, so maybe an introduction in an important case or a précis or something like that. And what you say in the courtroom is important because, I know I'm jumping all over the place here, but the idea of dealing with the press is our way, the only way, that we can get to the public. And the courts are public institutions, and I think it's really important for us to make sure that what we have done that affects somebody's lives is accurately reported, and it helps if we say it in a way that is digestible and understandable.
I would offer two things. First, if you have a sentencing where the guidelines are very much in dispute, and loss calculations being a pretty good one, or other aspects really in dispute, there's nothing wrong with suggesting to the court that they hold a hearing on the sentencing guideline calculation separate from the day of sentencing. And the advantage that has from the defense point of view is that when you're going to start yelling about is it 5 million or 3 million or something like that, it's not immediately tied to the judge having to make a decision what the appropriate sentence is. So it takes some of the emotional steam out of the ability to come to the correct sentencing guideline calculation.
I learned a long time ago in high-profile cases, too. I've had more than my share of high-profile trials, including President Trump testifying in my courtroom a couple years ago. I learned a long time ago not to read any coverage. When I'm in a high-profile trial, I don't read the press about it. I know what's going on in the courtroom. I don't need to read what they're saying. I don't want to read what they're saying. I don't want anything that I do in the courtroom to respond to what they are saying. So I just don't read any of the coverage. Doesn't stop some of my colleagues sometimes from sending me headlines. One, for those of you from Chicago will appreciate this. A couple years ago, there was a witness who needed a talking to at one point, and the headline the next day was, "Judge scolds the witness." And one of my colleagues, Jim Holderman, calls me and says, "Amy, why is it when you get after a witness, the mother of three, that it's Judge scolds? Right. When I do it, it's Judge rips into the witness."
I want to emphatically agree with what you just said, because having been a state court judge where many things are covered by the local media, and I've made this mistake, I'm the object lesson. If you read what's being printed about what's going on in the courtroom, it changes your focus. And instead of just trying to get it right and focusing on the matter in front of you, you have to battle this tendency to try to make statements that offer clarity to the people in their reporting on what's going on. So I learned that the hard way, but I don't read it either. And I think that's fantastic advice.
And I think this is a whole separate panel. And seriously, and goes to the question of whether or not courtroom proceedings should be televised and the nature of public access, because I am betraying my mature years by saying that when I started out, there was a reporter for federal court and there was a reporter for state court. And these reporters, the print media, I always assumed they had a law degree somewhere in their background, because they knew the certain, you know, this type of motion wasn't filed in federal court, it was filed in state court. Now, you have coverage and you have social media. And I had a case where one of the parties got on social media and told his followers, "Go to court to make sure Judge Williams mets out justice." Well, you know, the marshals wanted to know about that and who was going to come see me met out justice. But you can't, I believe, that isn't going to alter what I do and how I approach it. But it is a dimension of not only, I think, judging or practicing, but of our lives that you need to address in your own mind's eye how you integrate that into your job.
I think there's a number of threats to the right of public access to the court proceedings. More so in the civil arena, at least in a criminal case, you're going to have a plea and usually in a sentencing or a trial. So there are some hearings. In the civil context, you know, a lot of people talk about the vanishing trial. I think we might. There's also vanishing hearings. I mean, the federal courtrooms are on most days empty in the Houston Federal Courthouse where I sit. Judges are working hard, but in chambers, not a lot of interaction with lawyers. And so because of that, there's not a lot of ways for the public to access what's happening. And there's also, I've written about this, there's rampant oversealing of documents. Now, plea agreements with cooperation, obviously those should be sealed. Someone's life is at risk. But especially in the civil context, but stuff people do here, like SEC cases, the lawyers on both sides, there's agreed protective orders and we'll stamp everything confidential or highly confidential. And the lawyers agree, because, right, both sides often have documents they don't want out in the public. And so, as I think has been said earlier, as a judge, you've got this stack of stuff that's contested. Your impulse, when there's an agreed by the party's motion, you're going to grant it. But really, the lawyer shouldn't decide, be able to waive the public's right to access. So I think that's something courts need to be vigilant about. And public access, I mean, look, the public interest in the Ninth Circuit oral argument on the challenge to the executive order, I think hundreds of thousands of people were listening
in
real time.
It, I think.
Right. It was, I mean, you know, whatever you think about the decision, but I think it's a great thing when not just lawyers, but lay people are seeing how the system works, because it's certainly far from perfect. It has a lot of faults, but I think our federal judiciary is, you know, one of the Constitution's greatest contributions, and it's been emulated throughout the world, the independent judiciary. And I think it's the more people see it and the more people understand how it operates, I think the more respect the system will have, and there'll be, you know, the more comments the public can make to improve it.
I mean, I agree with that completely. We're the most transparent branch of government. I mean, we go into a courtroom, we hear from both sides, there's a court reporter who takes it all down, and then we say what we say, and the court reporter takes it all down, or we issue an opinion which is public, and then lawyers can go to the Court of Appeals and, you know, discuss all the issues all over again. So the more we wind up sealing things, the more that undermines those basic principles. And we all know that in certain criminal cases it has to be done, in certain pleas and cooperation. What I've done in a number of cases, but one that's going on now, a big civil case, that there's a lot of reasons to seal stuff. I have a standing order that you can agree to redact, you can file something under seal, but within 5 days, you have to redact. And I've got some principles about what can be redacted and what can't be redacted. You have to file a redacted version on the public record. And the two sides got into a fight about one side over-redacting, and the magistrate judge was working on it. But they know that they have to put something on the public record. And I may have to dive in from time to time to tell them you've over-redacted, but it isn't completely under seal.
On the Court of Appeals, I mean, I've seen briefs, healthcare fraud cases, 75-page brief, the government files, and it lists one of the Medicare beneficiaries' Social Security number. And I get that. That shouldn't be in the public domain. But because of that one 9-digit number, they've sealed the whole brief. When they should do what you said, which is redacted. Then my favorite, though, is the seal in a criminal case, the case name will be sealed appellee versus sealed appellant. Like, no one knows the United States is a party in a criminal case.
We're going to skip over, but my friends in the audience will be very surprised to hear me say we're going to skip over Brady. But I just want to, picking up on something that somebody said a few minutes ago, technology and the era of social media. How is technology affecting discovery in criminal cases? In particular, and discovery rules and rulings relating to electronic discovery, and how are social media affecting trials and, importantly, jurors and juries?
Well, I had when I was a baby AUSA, I had my first trial partner was a chief assistant, and he said, in terms of curative instructions and direction you gave to a juror, it's like telling a three-year-old, never, never put a bean up your nose. Because you know the first time that child is close to a bean, it will go up the nostril. And so you have to find a way, I think, to tell jurors, never, 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 never talk about this. But don't go on the Google, and don't research it, and don't put it on your Facebook page or your Twitter feed. And I have tried to find different ways to impress upon them. I'm not holding a red flag so that you go do it. But this is part of the oath you've taken, along with me, as now judges of the facts, to be impartial, and that it is about. It's not about somebody else's integrity, your husband or your son or your daughter or who you're, it's about your integrity. And we are counting on you to do that. But it is so all-pervasive, social media, that I actually said that to a juror once, and she gasped as if I had told her, I'm going to amputate your arm. But there are, you know, I don't know how many generations behind me, but there are people whose lives are lived in the social media, just in the technological world. And to keep them away from that, I think as a judge, that's one of the most important functions I am performing in a trial, is to cabin what they're attending to and listening to and deliberating on to what's happening in the courtroom, and it's so hard.
Any other thoughts?
Well, I tell the jurors, of course, all of that, that they can't, you know, don't do any investigation on your own, don't do this, don't do that, don't Twitter, don't do that, so forth. But then I try to enlist them in this common endeavor, and I explain to them that they are making a great sacrifice, that it's very unusual that they're sitting on a jury, because it's the one of two ways you can actually participate in this great civics experiment and give sort of the flag and justice and so forth. And then I say, at the end of the day, after you have spent 1 week or 2 weeks or whatever time it is, or 7 weeks,
yes,
you want to be able to have faith in the integrity of your own verdict. And the only way you'll have that is if you and your fellow jurors hear the same evidence, hear the same instructions, the same questions, and come and hear each other's views and come to a unanimous decision. That's the only way it's going to work. And so you don't want to go and expose yourself to some information that is uncross-examined, that may be false, and that may somehow influence your decision here. And I try to engage in that. Who knows? Does it work? I don't know. Do you think it works?
I don't know. But
I think it works with. I think it works with certainly the majority. The concern is always that there are one or two people who just cannot resist that temptation. But we do have to tell them.
It's
the use of social media is not generational anymore.
Right.
I ask during voir dire all the time, how many of you have a Facebook? Well, it's everybody from the grandmas to the college students that have Facebooks now and that actively use them. So, and they may not know. They honestly may not know that they shouldn't be posting things on there, because that's what they do, is they post stuff about their life on there all the time. So we do have an obligation to educate them that if you are using your Facebook, you can continue to use it, but don't post anything about this trial. And I even tell them, don't even post the fact that you're a juror on this trial on your Facebook, so that they understand. And then I go on similar to tell them why and the implications from doing so.
There's a related question, Paul, of I know some judges have prohibited the lawyers in jury selection from looking at social media. Judges have different views. My view is let them see it all, but there have been some orders from federal judges saying you can't research the jurors through social media.
These are hard issues. And some the people that can help you police this sometimes are fellow jurors. You give the message that you give, and one juror isn't following that advice, and the other juror is saying, we're spending all of our time here, and they'll come in and they'll tell you there's a problem. Are there questions about anything before we go hear Neil Eggleston at lunch? Because
right here.
Somebody's coming with a microphone, I think. You don't get chances to ask judges questions a lot.
I just had a quick question. I wanted to find out how the president's comments about the judiciary and the, you know, allegations of politicized judiciary are affecting you.
How his comments about
And comments about a politicized judiciary, so-called judges, these types of sentiments, and are you worried that the public might be thinking that way about the judiciary?
So that's not a controversial question.
We are so-called judges. I don't think I want to comment on that, but I will say this. I gave a talk many years ago at a time when Tom DeLay and others were going around criticizing judges. And I talked about the importance of the independence of the judiciary, which we have all spoken about to various groups, I'm sure. And the Chief Justice Rehnquist called it the crown jewel of our democracy, the independence of the judiciary. The fact that Congress can't lower our salaries and the only way they can get rid of us is to impeach us is a big deal. It really does make us independent to follow the law, but to do what we think is right. It's very hard for judges to go out and defend themselves. The bar has to do it for us. You, defense lawyers, prosecutors, plaintiffs' lawyers, defendants' lawyers, have to remind everybody how important an independent judiciary is to our system. The ABA created a commission on the independence of the judiciary right around that time. And it had to do with the Schiavo case and some other things. But the concern is that people begin to think of judges as just other politicians, but we happen to wear robes. It's not helped by the fact that they're elected judges in so many places, because they do have to run for office. But the federal judiciary, and most state judges too, despite the fact they have to run for office, really do act independently and try to do the right thing. And I think credibility, Congress is at the lowest at 9%, I guess, in terms of people that have faith in them. The Supreme Court and judges generally are pretty high, but I think it's only in the 40s now. And it used to be in the 70s or more. So I think there's a real concern anytime people attack or suggest motives that judges have other than to follow the rule of law and to try to do.
And I'm a Marine, so I don't mind charging into a dangerous area. I will tell you, it doesn't affect me at all. Historically, we are replete as a country with examples of other branches criticizing the judiciary. We're appointed for life, and that's for a reason. And that doesn't insulate us from criticism, fair or unfair. It doesn't change the way I do my job. It's not going to change the way I do my job. And if you look throughout our history in this country, I can't say it enough, there have been many times where the judiciary has been criticized and even attacked by the other branches of government. If we do our job to the extent that we can, if we have capable people like you defending us, I think we're going to be fine.
I was a public defender for so long, nobody even thought I was a lawyer. So, you know, this is way a step up for me. And I think that the thing that I did then that I would do, you do your job. You just do your job. And hopefully that keeps people's faith alive in the integrity, not only of the process, but as someone said, the grand experiment that is the democracy and the justice system. Over there.
There's one in the back here.
I have a 6-week trial coming up in federal
Speak
court.
Speak a little louder. It's on.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just bring
I have a trial coming up, and I have a voir dire question. I was hoping somebody would give me a little reaction to it. I'm interested in asking, with respect to the issue of activism, whether you would accept a question that was formed essentially, have you participated in an organized protest within the last 5 years? If you have any reaction to that.
Is the case about an organized protest?
No.
Oh, okay.
I think the feeling we should let the judge's case it is decide. Okay, well, there's another question.
But let me throw you a curveball on that. In the Middle District of Florida, it's the culture that most judges don't allow a lawyer voir dire at all. I don't. In specific circumstances where you can give me a rationale as to why high profile, different type of case, certainly that's considered. But in most of my cases, no lawyer voir dire.
I allow it, and they'll say until when, and I'll say until I don't. And that might be one of those questions that I would say, well then, Now we're done. But yeah, it has to have a relationship to the case. And I know what you want. You want to know everything about that juror, and it's right for you to want that. But it has to be cabined by not only time, which is a consideration for these jurors who are giving up their jobs, their homes, their lives for 7 weeks and don't want to be in voir dire for one of those weeks.
Well, you gave them today off.
Yeah, I did give them today off.
And forgive me, but Nanette reminded me, I do allow written submissions of proposed voir dire questions,
right.
Just no live voir dire.
And we've started in the Northern District a standard questionnaire that is given to the jurors in criminal cases. It was negotiated between the U.S. Attorney's Office and both the public defender and the CJA panel. It asks, I don't know, 25, 30 questions. It's very helpful, and it's been quite successful in reducing the amount of time for voir dire. And so judges sort of like it because it will move things along faster.
But you're trying to uncover bias or prejudice for that particular case. You know, if it's a gun case and somebody, then you might want to ask questions
right.
about person's attitudes on guns. But just because somebody exercises their First Amendment right, it may show that they have leadership potential, but it's not going to tell me whether or not they can be fair in a drug case or a Medicare fraud case or a slip and fall, maybe.
One last question, and then we'll need to wrap it up, right?
Thank you. You indicated that sentencing memoranda are very helpful to you at sentencing. I've practiced in a number of federal districts. I've never had a judge allow either side to have a blue sheet or be aware of the probation officer's recommendations. I've always thought that was a due process violation, but I'd be curious, to what extent are the recommendations of the probation officer important to you in arriving at a sentencing decision? And do you believe that those recommendations should be shared with both the prosecution and the defense?
In the Northern District of California, two answers. Number one, I think they're important, and the practice in the Northern District of California is disclosure.
I mean, I obviously think it's important to disclose, and I think, you know, having come immediately from a defense background, I think if people would be surprised at how often probation actually makes recommendations inuring to clients' benefit.
Absolutely.
And I think that disclosing helps to demonstrate that and also fosters more dialogue between the defense lawyer and maybe the U.S. attorney and the probation officer. But as far as accurately identifying a guideline range, I think it's an important tool for us.
Well, that part they get anyway.
Yeah.
The practice in D.C. has been not to disclose. The federal rules gives you the option. Practice has been in D.C. has been not to disclose. Some of our newer judges, those upstarts, have a different view, and I'm not sure it's a uniform practice. I meet with the probation officer the day before or the morning of sentencing, one-on-one, and it's very valuable. She or he is an officer of the court, an employee of the court. It's not an ex-party meeting. It's not a due process violation, and I talk to them about they've considering that 97% of the cases are pleas, and in some districts the magistrate judges take the pleas, you need to know by the time you get to sentencing as much as you can. And the probation officer will also speak in court, but I ask her, you know, so you went to the home, tell me about the home, tell me about the spouse or the girlfriend or the mother, tell me about the employee or when you went to visit the employer or the former employee. What's your impression of this guy? And then we talk about the guidelines and the recommended sentence and what I'm thinking about, because I've read all the sentencing memos and I've thought about it a lot and I've gone through the guidelines and I have my own views and I kick it around with her and then I go to court and I listen to the lawyers. There are a lot of defense lawyers who hate that.
I'm not a defense lawyer anymore.
I wasn't looking at you. No? But the idea that we would have a meeting with the probation officer, they find troubling. I view the probation officer as my law clerk on sentencing because he or she works for the court just like the law clerks do. And that's my independent source. And they know a hell of a lot more about than most law clerks do about the sentencing guidelines, about criminal defendants. A lot of them have backgrounds in sociology. They did not become probation officers to do guideline calculations. They became probation officers to help people.
I'm one of those upstarts, and I'll tell you that if I have questions for the probation officer, I feel pretty strongly that I need to ask them in the courtroom on the record. So if there's disagreement over what I'm being told, that the parties have a chance to correct that or dispute it. I don't think there's anything wrong either way, but I feel more comfortable with doing everything in the courtroom on the record. Again, this goes back, I'm sort of an amalgamation of everything I did wrong as a state court judge. As a state court judge, if you've ever had that instance where you go back with counsel and have a blunt conversation in chambers, I remember one time I made the mistake of making a comment to the prosecutor, "What are you doing? This sounds like a civil case you're prosecuting criminally." And out in the courtroom, when the case was prosecuted criminally, the defense attorney said, "You said back in chambers, blah, blah, blah," and I learned my lesson from that. Yeah. So I just prefer any status conferences I have, Rule 16 or otherwise, are all on the record with a court reporter there. I just feel it's better for all parties involved.
I think the only time the due process consideration, as far as I can see, it comes into play, I do what Paul does. If you are told something in chambers by the probation officer that is of significance, real significance to the sentencing.
Or new or different from what's in the report.
That's right. I go out on the, I don't necessarily say who gave it to me, but I have heard, or I've received information, or let me ask you this, and I disclose it. Because under 6A1.3, if there is a dispute, at least as to a particular fact that could affect the sentencing guidelines, but I think it's broader than that, due process requires disclosure. So that's the way I deal with it, exactly as you deal with it, but with that.
That's because we're the old timers.
Yeah, because years and years.
So Ray said we should finish at noon. Lunch is coming up with Neil Eggleston. I want to thank all of the panelists. They all worked very hard. We had a lot of...
Oh, you did.